start with the today's talk with the following areas we're going to cover. Introduction, what is the evidence? We will have to deal with that. Practical issues, which is everybody's question, and we hope that a good deal of the our experience, Indian component to the whole thing, and then we'll summarize the whole talk. So proven treatment strategies against SARS-CoV-2, which was highlighted both by the introductory chairpersons and Dr. Nand Kumar, is what has really made a difference in terms of randomized controlled trials and mortality is oxygen therapy, anti-inflammatory therapy, steroids, the recovery trial was touched on, anticoagulation, which is known to be beneficial, in what way, to what extent is still debatable, but it is there based on the thrombotic potential of COVID-19. And the antiviral strategy, remdesivir, is the most promising, and this is the topic of today's detailed discussion. So remdesivir, a few technical details, basically was described against Ebola, and it is wondrous how something can come up literally from the grave to be useful in a pandemic. I mean, Ebola was many years ago. Remdesivir came up, came as an option there. It never got used in a significant way because but in the midst of this came COVID-19, and remdesivir was literally taken out from an exhumed status and brought back probably be the drug of the year. Sorry, there's a background sound coming. Can we mute everything? Is it possible to mute everybody? Okay, sorry. So it is amazing how it has come back, and it probably be one of the most heavily used molecules and probably the antiviral used maximally in the history of medications because of the COVID pandemic, and it's expanded the utility also. The claim to fame of that is it basically is a RNA polymerase inhibitor, and we'll go into details of all that in the next few slides. So why is remdesivir there? It is a paradigm of source control. Ultimately, if an infection hits you, you need to control the infection. And source control, as you've learned from sepsis, infections, and so on and so forth, is the primary area where we put our energies. This drug fortunately came with a convenience of both the way it's acting directly on the viral replication area, pharmacokinetics, which is what we'll talk about, resistance, which fortunately has not been an issue, and dosing convenience because of its once-a-day properties. Remdesivir is specific for viral polymerases, and that is why it has low human toxicity, wide therapeutic index in the models which were used to develop the drug, exhibits a high genetic hurdle to resistance in coronaviruses. So we're talking of every entity so far, but resistance to antivirals, thankfully. We're talking reinfection, but not resistance. And it's extended half-life, which permits one daily dosing, a major advantage. It is a prodrug. It is metabolized to its active form, which is remdesivir triphosphate, which acts as an analog of ATP. And we'll show you some interesting, colorful pictures. It competes for incorporation by RNA-dependent RNA polymerase, RDRP. And this acronym is what has really been a major thing in the antiviral world. And thereby, it interferes with viral replication, which is the mechanism of source control. Viruses with mutations in RNA polymerase to develop partial resistance to remdesivir have been shown to be less infective. But these have not been part of the spectrum we have to deal with. So here you can see how the triphosphate moiety over here will go over here, attach to the viral thread. And over here, this will cleave off. And that is how viral replication is inhibited. And similar, this interesting picture shows here how, by and large, the action of remdesivir is where it acts by what we talked about earlier. And in that mechanism, completely viral replication and its ability to act on the nucleus and cause cytopathic effect is stopped by remdesivir. So theoretically, pathophysiologically, theoretically, and descriptively, a very, very strong mechanism. And that is why it came up very fast as an important drug to contend with in the COVID treatment armamentarium. Now, what is the evidence? It's very nice to have all this pathophysiology, but does it really work? And this is where we've had a big challenge, where both efficacy and safety has to be rapidly established in the COVID pandemic. And so as people were initially going through an onslaught in the Western world, when it started with China and built up to the United Kingdom, Europe, and North America, they had nothing with them. They had no drugs with them. And that is when Gilead was rapidly mobilizing remdesivir, and both use and trials were going on. In such a situation, we have multiple studies, and we'll try and do talk with them, and we spend some time on this ACTT study. Again, I'll not inundate you with data, but I'll try and tell you what actually led to some conviction coming in the use of this antiviral. So what was this study by and large? We'll try and get into that. But the two, three endpoints they were all trying to study were the following. One, time to recovery. That is this going to make your viral recovery faster? And if you understand why, you would know that most antivirals basically look at this endpoint. There's very few antivirals which look to save lives. They look to nip, when you nip the viral replication in the bud, by and large, you're looking at a faster recovery. The saving life part of it depends on the hit of the virus. Whether the virus causing it causes an extensive damage, multi-organ damage, inflammatory damage, thrombotic damage, as has been talked with COVID-19. So the mortality paradigm, though desirable, is not often achievable. And that is why time to recovery was the first thing always looked at. This time to recovery was, of course, augmented by words like clinical recovery and RT-PCR and so on and so forth. But multiple studies out there basically have targeted this particular aspect. When we look at the first one, it is compassionate use. And so you can make out this is a very rapid paper which comes out. In short, it's being used because it's desperation. The authors are smart enough to collect the data and put it out so that the world can benefit. And they call it compassionate use because it is not approved by any agency at that time. In this particular study, they saw improvement in most of the patients at that time receiving a low flow oxygen or no oxygen. But the sicker patients, obviously, you can see that the efficacy comes down. So this was the earliest trailer into the fact that this drug definitely needs to be explored, as we are struggling with trying to use HCQ and all the initial treatments, which have themselves gone through their own roller coaster. And then comes this major, major study, which has set the stage for initial approvals. ACTT, or acronym for Adaptive COVID-19 Treatment Trial. You can see the large number of patients. And this is where they looked at the whole gamut of moderate to severe COVID. So a good deal on oxygen. You can see that only 20% were on non-invasive modalities, and 1/4 of them were on other mechanical ventilation on ECMO, but most of them were on supplemental oxygen. Here also, if you look at the paradigm now, currently you'll find out more patients will be on NIV-HFNC and less on mechanical ventilation, because the COVID paradigm also shifted towards doing less ventilation and more NIV, which was not happening when these trials were done. Keep in mind, in the beginning part of the pandemic, aerosol was a major fear. Nobody wanted to have NIV-HFNC, so everyone was getting ventilated. So most of the initial data comes from at least a significant number of ventilated patients. The patients here were the age group we all see. This was a little weird. Median time from symptom to remdesivir, 9 days. So it reflects the fact that everywhere in the world, people wait. They don't hurry, then they have to reach providers. Providers have to think about it. And maybe this time it was also not that easy to get remdesivir, but this was a trial. So remdesivir was available and available fast. 9 days it took to get the remdesivir. 79% had one or more comorbidities, and that is reflective of what we have. And as hypertension and diabetes are a major part of what we also see, so also was seen in this particular study. Results, again, we talked of recovery. Understand these patients were late. They came at 9 days. Median time to recovery was 11 days versus 15 days in the remdesivir group. Recovered much faster versus the control group. Mortality was significant, was lower in the remdesivir group, 7 versus 12, but this was not statistically significant. The interesting part was this recovery benefit was seen in all subgroups, meaning the oxygen and the NIV and the non-invasive strategies, but not seen in the mechanically ventilated patients. So mechanically ventilated patients maybe are so sick that if you throw in an antiviral as a source control strategy, maybe the whole paradigm is already too late, that the other parts of it, the inflammatory, thrombotic, and the multi-system part is taking over. So we did not find an earlier recovery in the mechanical ventilated patients in this study. Adverse effects were initially significant, and most of them were okay. Anemia we can deal with. AKI was worrisome, and this was mentioned by the last speaker. And the other two were acceptable, considering it's a clutching at a straw. We're basically a drowning man clutching at a straw when we look at the hunt for antivirals and drugs in this pandemic. And so this was a particular study authored by Beagle et al. And it's a massive study recruiting 1,000 patients. And this was the text which said the same thing. 11 days versus 15 days. Yes, it's great. A mortality is lower, but not statistically significant if you look at the P number. Then came more studies out there. Parallelly, work was going on. This is one of the latest ones in August. They looked at moderate cases. Now, they defined moderate as SpO2 more than 94. While currently, the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare calls it mild. And our SpO2 90, 93 and below is called moderate, and less than 88 is called severe. So these guys called moderate this particular definition. Again, a good number of patients. Again, median duration, 8 days. Everywhere patients are coming late for antiviral administration. Again, they looked at the primary outcome similar to the prior study, 11 days clinical status. And they had something called ordinal scale, where they were trying to look at how sick the patients were. And in this particular trial, when they tried to see the clinical status at 11 days, reflecting the whole the prior paper, they saw that on day 11, patients in the 5-day remdesivir group, that means the patients who got remdesivir for 5 days, had a statistically significantly higher odds of a better clinical status distribution. A lot of words to say that they were doing better. And why is this language all ambiguous? Because unfortunately, they're trying to find the least common denominator of improvement, which will lead to approval of these drugs. Most of these are studies sponsored by the manufacturer. There has been hardly any other way of doing it in the pandemic because resources have been scant. And so many things have come out in this recovery time, this ordinal group classification, and mortality has been very, very difficult to show. And we talked about that in the beginning. So this was an interesting study. Earlier in the year, a Chinese study also, which came at that time, a double-blind placebo-controlled with 237 patients, showed that patients got better faster. The same thing. So the same duration, 9, 10, 11 is being talked about, with no increase in the radial effects in this study, giving a better safety signal than before. And you can see this was also published in a very prominent journal, The Lancet, and so on and so forth. And they also said that, yes, patients get better faster clinically. So now you have three words, clinical recovery, you have clinical improvement, and you have mortality. And in some way or the other, all of these are being used to try and show benefit. Ultimately, when the moment you have three or four papers and people are confused and saying, tell me the bottom line, comes a meta-analysis, which is supposed to be, I will tell you what to do based on all the papers. This meta-analysis looked at steroids and antivirals. And they said this global despondent statement that we don't have treatments. Yes, we know. But dexamethasone, yes, makes a big difference. And, you know, the mechanical ventilation patients, there was a 29% mortality in the dexa group and 41% in the non-dexa group. So you can imagine how many were dying at that time. And they said that remdesivir also reduces adverse effects. So a fourth entity came in. But clinical effects and treatment duration need confirmation. Other antivirals, no big advantage. This again was a living project we talked about. You can see the multi-country collaboration which is formed here. We go all the way from Denmark to Canada to China and so on and so forth. And so that is why, based on all these studies, the ACTT, the compassionate use, the other data which came in May, initially, very fast, the US FDA had given an EUA, hardly ever given in the history of approvals by the US FDA, that you can use it. You don't need to ask people because we have currently no option and people are dying. And they approved it only for severe coronavirus disease. In a month ago exactly, based on the expanding data, they increased the use of remdesivir. The EUA was expanded that you can give it to anybody with severe, to anybody who is hospitalized. And this created a whole controversy, because no longer did we have the acronyms of severe, mild, and moderate. If you put the patient in the hospital, you can give remdesivir. And the extrapolation to India was a problem, because in the US, at least one believes that you hospitalize for the right indications, which means unless you need oxygen, you don't get into the hospital. But in India, people have been hospitalized for everything from fear to I know the owner, to I need a bed, to I need to be away from home. So we have to be very sure that we take their approval and understand the science and apply the science to us, rather than give it to everybody who's got a saturation of 98, 99 and sitting in our hospitals. practical issues with remdesivir, which also was touched on partly, kidney part of it. And Nandkumar mentioned that, you know, it was a big problem to use in AKI, and partly because it causes AKI, and secondly, AKI is a part of COVID, so whether remdesivir was doing it or not, none of us know. And lastly, they go through multi-system issues, which itself could be causing AKI. And so the ESRD population also was a issue. And so in the beginning part of the pandemic, this has not been given, primarily due to the worry that the cyclodextrin carrier, similar to voriconazole, will accumulate and cause toxicity and renal issues, compounding the patient's already multiple woes. Then came the science over there that, sorry for these question marks, it's part of a, I think, a formatting thing, that by and large, that this cyclodextrin which is there, is it that bad? It is, the worry was it will accumulation will cause liver necrosis, renal tubular obstruction, and so on and so forth. But later down the line, they started looking at the amount of cyclodextrin, and they found out that the cyclodextrin is well below the maximum recommended safety threshold of 250 milligram per kg. So these numbers show that they're much lesser than what is supposed to be the toxic dose of cyclodextrin. In addition, it was also shown that it is removed by continuous RRT and HD, and accumulation only happens when dialysis is held. So a lot of these arguments came up to the fact that at least your CKD on dialysis, you can get away by using remdesivir and not worry about the cyclodextrin component. And so this was the paper which mentioned that over here, pretty recent it was, that in patients with acute and chronic disease, it can be looked at and can be utilized. So currently, very quickly, practice parameters have taken the application of remdesivir to at least CKD CRF on dialysis, and provocatively to people who have azotemia, which can be thought on a case-to-case basis. Pregnancy. Again, pregnancy, if you look at the package insert, you will never have a pregnant woman as part of treatment trials. Again, the word compassionate use extended to the pregnant population, and case reports show there's no problem. However, side effects may be there with hepatitis, and the pregnant people have their own problems with multiple issues with transaminitis and so on. And so again, off-label, compassionate use, emergency use authorization, its use has been extended to pregnant people also. And this is the paper review which recently talked about that. And again, the package insert says no, but this is part of what has been used in dire straits in complex situations. Hepatitis, I told you these numbers before, the percentage is around 6 to 8%, and currently periodic monitoring of LFT is required. And if your transaminitis is more than 5 times upper limit of normal, 200 to 50 or so, then you will have to think whether you can continue the drug. If the patient has pre-existing liver issues, you should not. And to due diligent effort to try and reduce the other hepatotoxic drugs would be a good idea. And so this liver injury in remdesivir-treated COVID-19 patients was also an interesting letter to the editor, and they reflected the same statements as we are trying to point out. The other thing was drug interactions. Again, role of the famous cytochrome enzyme metabolism was unclear. Caution with strong inducers is a challenge, and that is why it was a problem when patients with TB seizures are using remdesivir. And again, dexamethasone created a certain issue because dexamethasone has been the steroid mentioned in the recovery trial. But if there is a potential interaction, then it will be a problem. So often a practice parameter is that dexamethasone is replaced by remdesivir, but this is debated and people are doing things both ways. In the beginning, we were also trying to avoid the combination of dexamethasone and remdesivir. Clearly, we mentioned that other inhibitors and hepatotoxic drugs should be avoided, and this is the collection out there. And that is why, fortunately, lopinavir, ritonavir, went away very quickly. I think it's been like a relay race with a handover that this drug gave way to remdesivir, and we never had to look at both together or any combination antiviral strategy at this point. And so these particular combinations are to be looked at carefully. HCQ is another interaction. It may reduce levels, not to be used together. And again, one antiviral giving away to another antiviral has made this problem much lesser than we can imagine. And so here again, this is the same thing which is there in a publication where we talked of the fact that all these inducers and suppressors of this CYP450 are to be looked at. And particularly in practice, again, to reiterate and repeat, is going to be rifampicin, phenytoin, and plus minus dexamethasone. Dosage and duration, again, the chairperson's talked of this. Nandkumar mentioned in his patients out here. It's obviously the 200 milligrams day one. We made a big case based on pathophysiology, pharmacokinetics, and so on and so forth. That it's an OD drug. Again, the duration we will talk about more when we in the next few seconds. And then in patients less than 40 kg, you have to cut the dose accordingly. The duration has been a major issue, 5 days or 10 days. And recently, not recently, actually earlier in the year, a paper came that we should be used remdesivir for 5 or 10 days in severe COVID-19. This is only for severe COVID-19. And the paper, the review, I mean, the result was that in patients with severe COVID-19, not requiring mechanical ventilation, there is no significant difference between a 5 day course and a 10 day course. So it came down to the fact that if you just read the abstract, you're going to say, why should I give 10 days? However, there is a mortality benefit in the subset requiring mechanical ventilation in between 5 and 10 days. So this was a very subtle thing seen over there. And I'll try and put two things in perspective for you over here. If you look at the original AICT remdesivir papers, by the time you reach mechanical ventilation, patients don't recover faster. So in the original papers, there is no change in recovery on mechanical ventilation. On the other hand, if you look at 5 to 10 days, there is a mortality benefit in the subset, albeit small numbers, requiring mechanical ventilation. So in the original practice, it could be that if you are on ventilator, there is no advantage. But if you have started somebody on remdesivir, then it makes sense to go to 10 days. It's a little paradox, slightly difficult to understand, but it sets the stage for what is supposed to be done. Indian experience, let's talk of what we are seeing. Is it all trials or what have we seen in our particular studies? And in a single center, we became a dedicated COVID center when COVID hit Bangalore, and it was pretty bad. At that point, entire hospital of 100 plus beds became COVID. So we've had a good number of patients come by through our doors, and just, I think Coimbatore just followed us after that. In our initial 250 plus patients, which we have used, and we kept it at that time that by Indian criteria of moderate disease, that means if you desaturate less than 94, so 93 and below, you will be considered for remdesivir. And based on recovery, steroids will come side by side. Recovery means recovery trial. In our analysis, basically, we looked at what was there. Our patient profile was similar to the ACTT trial in terms of severity, age. I mentioned 59 and comorbidities. I'll show you all that. Median length of stay in our group, again, was similar, 11 days. So clearly Atlantic or Trans-Pacific, we're not seeing a huge difference between the Indian population. Sorry, these question marks are part of formatting. Overall mortality was higher in our group over there, in the sense that let me just come back to that over there. But early remdesivir appeared to make a difference. Mortality was 15% versus 37% if you used it early. And I will try and show you that over here. So in our study, we had 240 patients analyzed less than 9 days, and we started early. And we're quite happy with that because our mean time to from symptom onset to remdesivir was 5 days over here. So for most of the patients, in these patients, similar age group of around 57 years, you can see there's no difference in the p-value. We had a good number of CKD, AKI was reflected by the prior speaker. And of course, mechanically ventilated patients were there. Most of them were severe patients. The outcomes are the most interesting thing. In our single center analysis, the death component, first of all, the discharge people were more if the remdesivir was given earlier than 9 days, and this mean is around 5 days over here. So if most of the patients get discharged at that point, so this has been interesting, and we have to come back with this value. The more interesting part was we actually had a mortality benefit, that 15% people died when it was given earlier, as against 37% people. So this comes back to the statement I made. We had a slightly higher mortality than the international cohort because we took a sick bunch of people over here. So this is something new which we found, that there is a mortality benefit if remdesivir is given earlier, at least in this single center cohort of a sizable number of patients in the Indian spectrum. severity wise mortality was also an eye opener in the severe patients, which is again, as we talked about, saturation less than 88, we had a significant mortality benefit when it was given earlier than 9 days with a very, very significant p-value. However, when by the time they reach mechanical ventilator, we have no mortality advantage. So mechanical ventilation is an unusual thing. In the papers, you will not get a faster recovery, but 5 versus 10 days, 10 days are preferable. And in our analysis on mechanical ventilator, I mean, remdesivir is just doesn't seem to be making too much of a difference. I have set the stage of this with some controversies. Controversies are the inevitable aspect of a science moving too fast as the COVID toll climbs. And we presented the science of the last 7 months in I think now 25 minutes. Who do you give the drug to? And that is what? So US, FDA, EU has said you put them in a hospital, they qualify for remdesivir. Indian penetration, we cannot go by that criteria. I've said this before and I will say it again. I think we should still follow people who are reaching that desaturation potential should be the trigger for remdesivir so as to not use, abuse or misuse the drug, even though it's much easier available, at least in the metros. When to give? We have showed a case from the Indian data as soon as possible. Less than 9 days has a mortality benefit in moderate and severe categories. Whom not to give? It used to be renal, hepatic and pregnant. Pregnancy is inching in. Renal is expanding its spectrum and hepatic still stays a contraindication at this point. Unexpected side effects and drug interactions. We've defined some of them. More will come. We are also seeing that some of our patients with remdesivir and steroids and often these tachypnic ones also developing hypernatremia, which we are observing. How long to give the 5 versus 10 days at the foot? I have dealt with a little data perspective and maybe I'm not left too confused over there. Cascading effect. Do we believe that antiviral strategy has an effect on the anti-inflammatory component and the anti-thrombotic component? There's a big school of thought which says that if you hit the virus with good source control, you will at least mitigate, if not take away the anti-inflammatory and anti-thrombotic component, which is what we hope for. Then comes this, what is typically a practice which happens here, combination. People are using any combination together. Fabipiravir and remdesivir are also being used together. Where clearly practice, when you have 3 or 4 with you, you're taking arrow on arrow and firing. It is preceding the science, and I always try to show this picture from years ago where evidence is only this much, 6-7 papers, and practice is where anything is being thrown in at this point, any stage, any point, any dose, any duration, and these irrational combinations which are being used too often. So to summarize this extensive discussion on remdesivir data, practice, single center audit, it is the cornerstone agent for source control against SARS-CoV-2 as of September 30th. And a disclaimer is always given in COVID because data comes out fast. What is true yesterday is not true today. And it used to be at least 3-5 years before. Now, every 3 or 4 months, we are looking at our agents carefully. It has clearly demonstrated efficacy in moderate to severe COVID in terms of recovery time, please note, and not in terms of mortality, unless you take our paper or we manage to publish it and get it accepted. It came a little later in the COVID pandemic. So if you talk of to people who are either in the west of the world or you talk of even in India, and India is equal to 4 Americas and literally 20 Italy's. Mumbai, Delhi have not used a lot of remdesivir initially, but when it comes to south, we've started running with remdesivir, so much more familiarity, and you saw the numbers. Adverse drug reactions, we discussed nephrohepatotoxicity with the reduced fear of the kidney side effects and the ongoing watch for the liver side effects. Again, with procon analysis and pregnancy also, as we discussed. Drug interactions of the minimalistic nature were talked about in the discussion also. Clearly, if we look at time as being, if you look at China, there was no remdesivir. I think remdesivir hits the ground maybe by May or so. So the last 5 months, if we call that a sizable amount of time, it has stood the trial of time, but still needs to withstand the lens of science as we look for all the fancy numbers of mortality and so on and so forth. But we have to understand that when we're treating COVID by the seat of our pants, we have used it both initially as a compassionate use, then as an emergency authorization. Now it has come to 6-7 companies which are supplying. It has hit even Indian government supplies across the country. And now it is used ubiquitously and, like we said, sometimes abused, overused, and inappropriately used when it comes to COVID treatment.